JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for September the 9th. I am Charalambos Pissouros, head of research here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the US dollar traded higher against all but one of the other major currencies on Wednesday and during the Asian session Thursday. It gained the most versus CAD, AUD and NZD in that order, while it lost some ground only versus the Japanese yen. The strengthening of the US dollar and the safe haven yen, combined with the weakening of the risk-linked currencies Aussie, Loonie and Kiwi, suggests that financial markets traded in a risk-off fashion yesterday and today in Asia. Indeed, looking at the performance in the equity world, we see that major EU and US indices were a sea of red, with a negative appetite rolling into the Asian session today. The only exception was China Shanghai Composite, which gained 0.45%. Now, EU shares may have stayed under selling pressure on growing expectations that the ECB may indeed announce a slowdown in its pandemic emergency purchase program today. Later in the day, sentiment took another hit after several Fed officials signaled that they still expect to begin trimming their quantitative easing purchases before the end of this year, despite the slowdown in jobs growth seen in August. Specifically, St. Louis Fed President James Bullard said that the big picture is that the taper will get going this year and will end some time by the first half of next year. While Dallas Fed President Robert Kaplan said that he still supports the process to start in October. New York President John Williams held a similar view, saying that assuming the economy continues to improve as anticipated, it could be appropriate to start reducing the pace of asset purchases this year. Recently, stocks were in an upside trajectory on falling expectations that the Fed will taper this year, and this was due to the latest disappointing US jobs data. However, yesterday's remarks revived hopes on that front, and bearing also in mind that investors were already cautious ahead of the ECB, this resulted in a pullback in equities and further recovery in the greenback. Kaplan's remarks may have revived some speculation that an official announcement may come as early as at this month's gathering, but we see as a more likely case the official announcement to come in November, as most policymakers may prefer to wait for the upcoming employment report to see whether the latest miss was a one-off incident or not. Now, yesterday we also had a Bank of Canada monetary policy decision. As was widely expected, this bank kept interest rates at a record low of 0.25% and maintained its current quantitative easing program. In the statement, it was noted that they expect growth to strengthen in the second half, though a fourth coronavirus wave and supply bottlenecks could weigh on the recovery. What's more, they maintained the guidance that the economic slack would be absorbed sometime in the second half of 2022, which means that this is when they expect to start raising interest rates. Now, following the latest disappointing data, especially the economic contraction in the second quarter, many participants may have been expecting the bank to announce a delay in its tapering plans. However, that was not the case. Yes, there was no action at this gathering, but this could be due to the fact that the federal elections are planned in less than 2 weeks, perhaps because this was a smaller meeting with no updated economic projections and a press conference. In our view, the door for a further tapering in October remains open, but we prefer to watch out for upcoming data releases before we arrive to more safe conclusions on that front. Further weakness could diminish the chances for such an action and perhaps keep the loonie underselling interest. Now, today, as we already noted, it's the turn of the ECB to decide on its monetary policy. At its latest gathering, this bank kept all of its settings untouched, but changed its forward guidance, saying that it will keep interest rates at present or lower levels until it sees inflation reaching 2%, well ahead of the end of its projection horizon, which may also imply a period during which inflation moderately overshoots that objective. In our view, this translates into willingness to hold rates low for much longer than the previous guidance suggested. With the bank unlikely to make any guidance changes at this meeting, all the attention is likely to fall on its quantitative easing programs. With the economic recovery gathering pace in the bloc, inflation in August accelerated to a rate not seen in the past decade, with the underlying metric getting closer to the bank's new 2% target. ECB President Lagarde and some of her colleagues consider the jump to be driven by one of pandemic-related effects, and thus they don't want to rush into policy changes. However, others, including Vice President Luis de Guindos and Governing Council member Jens Widmann, believe that they should consider gradually scaling back their programs, with the volume of the hawkish voices increasing lately. With that in mind, according to media reports, many market participants believe that officials will reduce the pace of their PEP program to 60 billion euros per month from the current 80 billion, before another fall early next year and a scheduled end in March. However, even if they scale down the PEP program due to approaching its expiry, we believe that they could compensate by making more purchases through other schemes. Now, as for the euro, it could gain on a tapering decision, but whether the rally will be strong and long-lasting will depend on any accompanying decision on other schemes and any remarks on future plans. Now, in case officials decide to wait for a while longer before proceeding with the tapering step, the euro is likely to depreciate. In our view, this is not an unreasonable scenario. Some officials may prefer to wait and see what happens with the pandemic and its new mutations after the summer. Now, as for the rest of today's events, the only other events worth mentioning besides the ECB decision are the US initial jobless claims for last week, which are forecast to have slid to 335K from 340K, and the Energy Information Administration report on crude oil inventories for last week, which is expected to reveal a 4.612 million barrels slide, following a 7.169 million tumble the week before. That said, bearing in mind that the American Petroleum Institute revealed a 2.882 million barrel slide, we would consider the risks of the Energy Information Administration number as tilted to the upside. As for the speakers, besides ECB President Christine Lagarde, who will speak at the press conference following her bank's decision, we will also get to hear from New York Fed President John Williams, San Francisco Fed President Mary Daly, Fed Board Governor Michelle Bowman, and Bank of Canada Governor Tiff Macklem. Daly and Bowman may provide their own view on the Fed's future course of action, while Macklem could provide clearer hints as to whether his bank is planning to proceed with another tapering step in October. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 o'clock AM GMT time. You can find the link in the description below. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.